Ah, good ol' E3. Every year I had to hear half the people get unreasonably hyped for it, while the other half piss and moan about how terrible it is and how E3 should be abolished, and it's not like both sides aren't right, they're just talking past each other. E3 is great because it's a gigantic pile of trailers in the middle of the summer game drought, showing you what to get excited about for the upcoming holiday season as well as 2 years down the road. But Christ, what a stupid waste of money those dumb stage shows were. Like, okay, cool, Sony, you remade an area from The Last of Us 2, great. But no one but a bunch of game journalists are gonna see that shit. It ain't Disneyland, and what, you hired a fiddle player? Why? Who cares? What purpose does it serve? How does this sell game? When Nintendo bowed out of doing an E3 press conference only to surprise the world with the birth of the Nintendo Direct, it was the best thing that could have happened. Scripted, edited, and refined, the Nintendo Direct not only gave Nintendo greater control of their presentation, but it cut out all the fat. Just, hello, I am Nintendo Man, here are games, and bam, games. That's what people want, and damn it, it's cheaper than doing an E3 bullshit too. Now everyone is doing it. We just had an Oculus Direct, a Dragon Quest Direct, a Sonic Direct, and a Monster Hunter Direct. And with the pandemic forcing E3 to go all digital, well, really, there is no E3 anymore. People just be dropping trailers. Better still, since it's no longer tied to some dumb Western event in California, Japanese devs are dropping trailers too. So heck with it. I used to do a yearly E3 recap where I reminded all my disappointed friends all the actually awesome stuff shown at E3 that year. Gosh darn it, so many trailers have already dropped that I can do a part one of my E3 2021 right now. And looking at the reactions, I think we need it. I heard one person say that the theme of this year's E3 is Japanese devs not knowing how to read the room, and they're not wrong. A Dragon Quest Direct that flaunted in our faces how we'll never get to play Dragon Quest X, a Sonic Direct that focused primarily on guest appearances and ports with only a tease of an actual new game, like, why would you even do a Sonic Direct if you have nothing to show? Nobody forced you, this wasn't necessary. But if you went in with no expectations like I did, then there was plenty of cool stuff shown. So let's get started. So first of all, Virtua Fighter 5 Ultimate Showdown. A couple months back, Sega announced that they were going to do something with Virtua Fighter, and now, bam, Virtua Fighter 5 Ultimate Showdown! It comes out, like, next week, and it's Virtua Fighter 5 running on the Yakuza engine. Okay, that's cool, kinda came out of nowhere, but we'll see. I know some people are probably wondering, why is it not Virtua Fighter 6? Well, to be blunt, that'd be really hard to do. Virtua Fighter was kind of Yu Suzuki's baby, and he sort of left Sega, and I don't know how many people who actually know how to make a Virtua Fighter are there. Virtua Fighter is generally considered a very exacting game, so you can't just pull one out of your ass. And at the same time, let's just be honest, Virtua Fighter has never actually been successful. It's the greatest fighting game no one actually plays. Oh, there'll be tons of people calling it the greatest, most balanced fighter ever, but yeah, no one will actually play the effing game. So Sega's probably testing the waters with this. Now, I'm gonna be honest, when I first saw the trailer on IGN, I was very concerned. To be blunt, it's been a rough generation for fighters. Yeah, a lot of them have come out, but they've kind of been half-assed and thrown together in less than a year. They've been a lot of downgrades compared to last generation, I'm sorry to say. So I was afraid this might be another one, but no. Thankfully, a Japanese trailer dropped that gives us actual information, which is going to be a bit of a recurring theme here. And yeah, based on the Japanese trailer, this looks to be the version of the game that was released on Xbox Live Arcade, but redone in the Yakuza Dragon engine. Meaning that it will not have the big meaty arcade campaign mode of Virtua Fighters 4 and Vanilla 5, but it does have a single player arcade mode, it does have a training mode, and most importantly, it has customization items. And you're probably wondering, why is that important? Easy, Vanessa. In case you don't remember, which I'm sure you do, Virtua Fighter 4 introduced a muscular black woman named Vanessa, and then Virtua Fighter 5 made her pale and scrawny, and everyone has been pissed about it ever since. She looks a little darker in the home version, and even a little darker here, that's nice, but it's still not back to her former glory, but using customization items, you can absolutely do that in Virtua Fighter 5. Knowing the customization items are back means that, yes, we can do that. And I was concerned about this because they were redoing the character models, so that means they gotta redo those customization items. That said, the customization items, much like on Xbox Live Arcade, it looks like these are going to be paid DLC. Fingers crossed they don't botch the pricing. And yeah, it looks like the game is going to be free on PS Plus. In fact, I don't see any other way to buy the game that they've shown. They have not given it a price. So this could be a thing like Tetris 99 and Pac-Man 99, where Sony paid for it and they wanted some free with PS Plus game to just sit there. But at the same time, I'm hearing it's only for the next 2 months, so I don't really know what's going on. That said, the Japanese title of the game, which really made it all click with me, is Virtua Fighter 5 Esports. Which Sega already made a game with a similar title, Puyo Puyo Esports, which was a $6 cut-down Puyo Puyo game, with the idea being, you know, hey, it's super cheap, so it's super easy to play online with. Also worth mentioning, there is a Virtua Fighter 1 graphics mode, and I fully intend to use that because I love the way Virtua Fighter 1 looks. I actually remember as a kid being disappointed in Virtua Fighter 2 because, and I quote, it wasn't virtual anymore. I love the old flat-shaded polygon looks. I'm looking forward to playing that. That said, a lot of people are disappointed because Sega did reveal that this will be using delay-based netcode and not rollback. Having said that, Virtua Fighter 5's netcode was like the first game with good online netcode in the pre-rollback era. I actually played that game successfully online when I had to do my internet through cell phones, okay? It was actually pretty darn good. Having said that, if there is an area of concern, it's the fact that this is a port from 360 PS3, right? Because unfortunately, it's possible they may have botched the netcode in the porting process. I have a friend who plays Virtua Fighter 5 online with a group of people on Discord, and they use the PS3 360 version, not the ones included in Yakuza. I think some of it might be because of frame rate, but I think it might also be because the netcode is better. And that wouldn't be a surprise. There were a lot of fighters that had better netcode late last generation than they do this gen. Soul Calibur 5 has way better netcode than Soul Calibur 6. Me and the aforementioned friend tried it. I swear Tekken Tag 2 has better netcode than Tekken 7. I even would go as far as to say BlazBlue had better netcode last generation. Like, I think something went wrong. Like, everyone got the netcode right last generation, and then they reused the same netcode on new hardware, and something went wrong with the architecture that's not making it work right. Just a theory, but either way, yeah, that is an area to be concerned in. But thankfully, if the netcode is bad, they can patch it post-release, which is not something they would have been able to do last generation due to Microsoft's way they handled patching. Either way, yes, Virtua Fighter 5 Ultimate comes out next Tuesday. It's free if you got PS Plus. And I know there's a bunch of people going, why is it not on PC? And this is a thing you need to understand. Japan doesn't play games on PC. It's kind of a cultural thing. It's a long story. But to make it way shorter, like, most of it is because PCs are very Western and Japan likes to stick with Japanese stuff. But it's also the fact that PC parts are generally from Western companies. There's not a lot of, like, Japanese local PC parts that they have access to. As such, building a PC in Japan costs twice as much as it does building it in America. And even in America right now, it's very expensive to make a PC. I know it used to be affordable, but thanks to crypto mining, the price of graphics cards and CPUs have skyrocketed to unreasonable levels and made it almost impossible. I know because I have two friends desperately trying to make the switch to PC gaming and saving up money, and they can't because the prices are just too stupidly high. So, I'm not saying it shouldn't come to PC, I'm saying that it's a Japanese game that mostly only appeals to a Japanese audience, so there's no point in their eyes I'm putting it on PC. A lot of these games I'm going to talk about don't have a PC port announced yet. I hope they announce one later. But if they're focusing on a Japanese audience, they're not going to talk about PC. It's a cultural thing. I should probably go into detail later, but Niche Gamer already has a video talking about it a little bit, but missing a few important points, like the fact that the PC-98 and Sharp X68000 aren't PCs. They're as PC as a Mac is, okay? When we say PC, we mean IBM PC compatible. It's an easy thing to forget. Anyway, moving on. So, how about that ridiculous Sonic Direct, where they showed a brief teaser of a new Sonic game at the end, and that's it. And a lot of guest appearance. That was weird. But, hey, Sonic Colors Ultimate, I'm sensing a theme here, looks great. Switch port of Sonic Colors with enhanced graphics. Sonic Colors is one of the good, well-received Sonic games. It'll be fun to play it again. And I love that they have a new song they've cooked up, because cheesy vocal Sonic music is actually my favorite musical genre, so I really look forward to hearing the full version of that. Also, they announced a new Sonic collection, the Sonic Origins collection, and oh my goodness. It's easy to forget what an absolute clusterfuck trying to make a Sonic collection is. As they showed Sonic 1 and 2 in widescreen, meaning that they are the remade versions made for mobile devices and stuff, but Sonic 3, they did not show in widescreen, but I'm hearing that it does have a widescreen option. But then it raises the question, is it Sonic 3 and Sonic and Knuckles, or is it Sonic 3 and Knuckles? Because that's an important distinction, and can we play the two separately and together? And then there's the question of what kind of music is in there, and oh my god, I'm so glad I'm not that obsessive of a Sonic fan, because that is a headache. I'm sorry, you guys. Fingers crossed this turns out okay. Because honestly, that's the saddest thing with these kinds of ports, is that it's easy to see, oh hey, a pile of retro emulated games, but it's entirely plausible to completely fuck that up. Also, Sonic the Fighters is gonna be in Lost Judgment. Guess I'm buying Lost Judgment. What? I really like Sonic the Fighters. It's a good game. But yeah, that's the Sonic Direct, I guess. Either way, Sonic Colors Ultimate looks fun, and people won't say no to a Sonic collection. So, Dragon Quest Direct. You know why I was disappointed in the Dragon Quest Direct? No sign of Dragon Quest monsters. They announced a new Dragon Quest monsters like 2 years ago, and where is it? It looks like it's kind of turned into Dragon Quest Treasures, which is there, but where's the new monsters? I think they said they have a new monsters in development, and I really, really want that because, well, to be blunt, Pokemon completely fucked up, and someone needs to step in and take over, and where in the entire crap are all the Pokemon competitors? Like, seriously, everyone's slacking on the job, and Pokemon is laying there injured. Dragon Quest Monsters, please, kill this effing thing. Because I'm sorry, no, the backlash against Pokemon Sword and Shield in the National Dex was completely justified, and to make a long story short, which we will get into at a later date, Pokemon Sword and Shield is ransomware. Pokemon is ransomware now. So I would really like a Dragon Quest Monsters, please. And if you're wondering, Dragon Quest Monsters is stupid popular in Japan. So I have my fingers crossed that when they do finally show a Dragon Quest Monsters, that they will make it on Switch and very good, because I very much look forward to that. Also, apparently Dragon Quest X, which is an MMO that will pretty much never be released here in North America, is apparently still continuing with like a sixth expansion. But also, there's apparently going to be a like offline version of Dragon Quest X, but unfortunately with chibi characters. Curious to see how that's going to turn out, like basically a single player adaptation. I'm disappointed in the chibi characters though, because they have these really sexy ogre girls that you can play as, and I want to play as them, and you made them chibi. Come on, guys. But you know what didn't disappoint me in the Dragon Quest Direct? Freaking Dragon Quest 3 HD 3D thing octopath stuff. Oh my gosh, yes. I was just thinking about how much I wanted to play Dragon Quest III again. I have a friend who's been thinking about how much he wants Dragon Quest III. And I know, like, when I mentioned this, someone was like, well, I've got Dragon Quest III on my phone if I ever want to play it. Yeah, and that's a really shitty mobile port, as is the current version on Switch and PS4. No, that needs a do-over. For those of you unfamiliar, Dragon Quest III is one of the best Dragon Quests. I'm gonna come clean, even though I call my channel Game Babble after a mistranslation of the Bubble Slimes. I'm not that big of a fan of the mainline Dragon Quest games. I like the spin-offs. I like, you know, Kenshin Dragon Quest and Dragon Quest Monsters. But the mainline games, I really only like 3 and 9, because those are the ones with custom parties. But 3, I think, is actually the game that caused the infamous Dragon Quest law to be put in place because so many people rushed out to buy it. As I said, it's one where you get to make your party from a bunch of generic classes, and on top of that, the game is kind of double length. See, after you seemingly beat the game, you get transported to another world, and there's an entire second game, and then at the end, it somehow manages to be a prequel to all the other Dragon Quests, which had to be the most mind-blowing thing back in the 80s. So it has a very particular amount of staying power. This friggin' HD pixel art 3D Octopath remake thing looks gorgeous. I can't wait to get my hands on it. I love the fact that we've got a little bit of back view-ness in the battle system. Man, I've been thinking about trying to attempt an all-bunny girl playthrough of that game, and this looks like no better time to do it. I wonder if it's possible to actually make the bunny girls, like, a functional party member. I'm probably asking for too much. Either way, that's the Dragon Quest Direct. Dragon Quest III? That looks good. I want it. I want it very badly. I'm very excited for that one. But hey, you know who is providing us with some actual Pokemon competition, thank freaking goodness? Capcom with Monster Hunter Stories 2. Now here's the thing, not the biggest fan of Monster Hunter, and I never played Monster Hunter Stories 1. I'm picking up 2 though. This game looks fantastic, and Capcom definitely knows how to push the Switch's visuals. I'm so happy to see what they're doing. Trust me and Capcom have a love-hate relationship. Mostly I just hate their fanboys, but credit where credit's due, they are actually showing us what the Nintendo Switch is really capable of, making games that are specifically tuned for it. I've heard people hold up Monster Hunter Stories 1 as an example of how a more open-world Pokemon Sword and Shield wild area-like version of Pokemon was entirely possible on 3DS, and they just didn't do it. And Monster Hunter Stories 2 looks beautiful. And yeah, it is a Pokemon-esque monster training game, but with big, fancy, fully voice-acted RPG cutscenes. And yeah, the monsters from Monster Hunter, which at the end of one of the trailers, they showed the fluffy bat thing. So I'm happy about that. I want to get that on my team. I'm happy to see someone make an effing Pokemon competitor that isn't Temtem. Temtem sucks. I'm sorry. I tried. I had to refund that shit. No. Thank you for Monster Hunter Stories 2, Capcom. I look forward to trying it. But you know what? Fuck all that shit. EDF. Earth Defense Force 6 had its trailer drop, and it's looking good. It will, of course, be a continuation after Earth Defense Force 5. For those of you not noticing the pattern, Earth Defense Force reboots every 2 games. The reason for this is because Earth Defense Force is about Earth being invaded by aliens. And you can only be invaded by aliens the first time so many times. So, the way they have it set up is the first game is, oh no, Earth is being attacked by aliens. And then game 2 is, now the aliens are back and we have to fight them with our better technology, right? So that's the theme, and then every time they change the name of the invaders. I don't know what the first 2 games were. I think those were just invaders. Obviously, 3 and 4 were the Ravagers, and then 5 and 6 are the Primers. Mind you, those are their American names. In Japan, they have names that would get them in a lot more trouble in America because they don't get the joke. The Ravagers in Japan are called the Foreigners, and the Primers in Japan are called the immigrants. The joke is, those are both other names for aliens. What's more, it's not Gaijin. They're never called Gaijin. It's foreigner in English. The Foreina. But yeah, no, people would think that EDF has some kind of political bend if they tried to do that, which it fucking doesn't. So they just leave those names in Japan. Either way, looks like an EDF 6 the aliens won, and we're emerging from the ashes to fight them back. Either way, we're looking at it building off of 5 and being more of the same, and that's hardly a bad thing. Moving on, an English trailer dropped for EDF World Brothers, which is the new Yuke's EDF game. It looks like Yuke's has signed on to be the Earth Defense Force B team after having created Iron Rain. For those unfamiliar, Yuke's used to do the yearly WWE game, but after they tried to make another wrestling game simultaneously because they had market dominance and didn't feel challenged, they were fired from WWE, and that resulted in the complete disaster that was WWE 2K20. They are still working on another wrestling game. People are suggesting it might be AEW. I wish them the best of luck, though, and I'm glad to have them on board making Earth Defense Force. And hey, worst case scenario, you could always just make a new Evil Zone, you guys. Okay, that's not happening. But either way, Earth Defense Force World Brothers is a 3D pixel. We are not calling those voxels. A 3D block pixel version of Earth Defense Force with a focus on collectible little chibi characters and fighting in small blocky environments. The idea is just buckets of content. There's over 100 characters to collect. There's tons of stages. They've got block versions of enemies from all the previous EDFs. And you can equip each character with one weapon, but you can tag between 3 different characters. And I'm very happy to see that the PlayStation 4 version of the game does have proper 2-player split screen. And wait a second. Launch trailer? When does it... It's out today? Well, crap. So, yeah, I'm downloading that right now, and looks like it's already got a pile of DLC, which includes Aya and Saki from Onee-chan Bar. Well, that's happening. It's currently on sale on Switch, so might be a good idea to grab it now if you're an EDF nerd like me. I'll let you know how it turns out. But if you want even more EDF, Earth Defense Force 2 is coming to Switch. And I'm very happy about this because I recommended they did for them to do this back when the Switch launched. I really want a proper EDF on Switch, and what better game than EDF 2? So, for those unfamiliar, Earth Defense Force 2 is still considered one of the best games in the series. The reason for this is because it has greater enemy variety than a lot of the other Earth Defense Force games, and I always liked it because EDF 2 is more War of the Worlds theme. Like, the UFOs look straight out of War of the Worlds. It's got 2 different flavors of tripods. And for me, those were always the thing. Everyone else is like, oh, Earth Defense Force about fighting bugs. I'm like, no, tripods and Godzilla, those are the best. Those are my favorite enemies in the series. So I'm very happy to see those back. Here's the thing, though. This isn't just the old PS2 game. They had actually already remade EDF2 for the Vita. And when they remade it on Vita, they added in an entire new class, an EDF2 version of the Air Raider, as well as 4-player online play. Me and my friend actually tried this out, and it was fantastic. And I'm very, very happy to see it coming to Nintendo Switch, with a better frame rate, the extra character, and the online play. Only thing is, I did not see them add split screen in. This is a major concern for me. I'm very focused on local multiplayer. It's very important to me. There will probably be system link, but I did not see split screen. For the record, EDF World Brothers, there's split screen on PS4, but not on Switch. Switch has system link. But if you still want more EDF, they have already announced that EDF 3 is also getting a Switch port because it also got an enhanced Vita port. If you don't remember, Earth Defense Force 3 is Earth Defense Force 2017, but the Vita port, which will be coming to Switch, added in the Wing Diver as well as 4-player simultaneous online play. Yes, I am very, very hyped for that. Hey there, Future Gel editing this in here. I did give World Brothers a chance, and wow, I did not expect it to be as ludicrously goofy as it is. Like, it's very, G-Gundam, shall we say. Like, in one of the missions, you get, like, a little Holland-made girl who can grow giant tulips that damage enemies, and her super move is to create a tornado-shooting windmill turret, and you get a guy in a sombrero called the Amigo Brother, and he can throw Molotovs, and yeah, this game is nutty, and that's not even getting into the time-traveling ninja that you have to go on 3 missions to try to make miso soup for. It's very Saturday morning cartoon, and it's an absolute blast, a bit different from normal EDF, but still very much is EDF. Lots of lore references. DLC actually includes Aya and Saki from Onee-chan Bara, as well as Riho Futaba from literally all of those budget games. You know, the girl in the blue bikini from Demolition Girl and all the other budget games. Yeah, she's in there, and she's voiced by her original Japanese voice actress speaking English, who is also the voice actress for Mikuru from Suzumiya Haruhi. Having said that, big piece of advice, don't get this on Switch. I have it on Switch and PC because it looks like all my friends are going to buy the PC release. And yeah, the Switch one runs fine enough. I think it's running at 30 though, but the resolution is unforgivably low, and it actually makes the game kind of difficult to read when you're playing it on a TV. It's just so blurry. And yeah, no split screen on Switch either. That's only System Link. I was a little bit on the fence playing it on Switch, but when I picked up the PC version, which is like nice and crispy and 60 FPS, oh egad, the game is way more fun. Having said that, I did try the Switch version in handheld mode, and it's fine. Like, it runs the same as it does on a TV, but when it's shrunk down to that little screen, it's like, yeah, you don't notice the resolution difference because you got the small screen. It's good for a portable game, but you don't want to play that on a TV. Having said that, unfortunately, the PC release has no local multiplayer at all, no split screen. Online, yes, but split screen is apparently PS4 exclusive, and I have not yet tried the PS4 version yet, and I'd like to not because I've already bought the game twice. But there you go, this game is definitely something special. Now, I feel like I would be doing this wrong if I didn't talk about Tales of Arise. And this is one where I gotta be honest with y'all. The game looks beautiful. This looks like the most polished AAA Tales game I've ever seen. And I have absolutely zero interest in it. It looks like a good game, but they've pretty much removed everything I love about Tales from Arise. See, here's the thing. Tales isn't meant to be a AAA game, and there's a reason for that. No Tales game really gets it all right, and it's never because there isn't enough budget, and it's never because there isn't enough time. It's just the Tales games are kinda all over the place. I would say that Tales games have 3 major components: story, characters, and combat system, and that no game gets all 3 right, and every Tales fan has different elements they focus on. Me, I care about combat first, characters second, don't give a crap about story. I'm here for the combat. In fact, I got into the Tales series with Eternia because it was sold to me as an RPG with a 4-player co-op 2D fighting game for a battle system. I've been very displeased by the move to 3D, to be completely honest with you, and I'm super salty that we haven't gotten any of the 2D games in America, which is of course why I'm absolutely overjoyed by the fan translation of Tales of Destiny for PS2, which is my literal dream Tales game, my absolute favorite. I am loving it. I am holding back tears from how much I love that. But if Tales of Destiny PS2 is what I want in a Tales game, Arise is what I don't want. See, the problem with this game is, well, they're still using the free-running battle system of Berseria, which isn't linear motion. Using that battle system does give you more maneuverability, but it cuts back on the number of attack options available to you, and again, it doesn't feel like a 2D fighter. I like the side-scrolling nature. That doesn't mean it's a bad battle system, but I'd call it way more generic, because there's a lot of games with a similar 3D free-running battle system. And I have to ask, at that point, what's the difference between Tales and Yi's 8 and 9? Which, those are fantastic games, and I like them. But that's the thing, they've already scratched that itch. Nothing's scratching my proper Tales itch. But this has been a bit of a theme here. The main thing that, like, kills Arise for me? No multiplayer. Yeah. Now, I know multiplayer has always been a tacked-on feature. It's never been the main focus. It's always been a bonus thing. But like I said, I play the Tales games because I want a four-player simultaneous co-op fighting game for a battle system in my RPG. This one is neither like a fighting game or four-player co-op. So, what's left? You've got a solid-looking action RPG, but now you have to sell me on something else. And unfortunately, these characters, while they look good, they don't look so good I'd buy the game just to play them. Which, for the record, is a thing I do. I'm a very character-centric person. I will play complete garbage if you manage to put an awesome enough character in your game. But this isn't doing it. The characters are good, and if it played more like the older Tales games, I'd be in. But this is not the direction I want to see the series go in. I picked up Berseria out of loyalty to the series, but I'm not doing it again for Arise. And again, I'm not saying it's a bad game. It'll probably be a very good game, but it could be the end of my involvement with the Tales franchise. I could be done, because this isn't a Tales game. It's just an action RPG. And this also shows the problem with Tales going full AAA. The fact that we've had to wait 5 friggin' years for them to put this blasted thing together. Because, yes, it'd be wonderful if my absolute dream Tales game also had a AAA budget, but these games are all over the place. And what happens, you know, the worst case scenario is, hey, here's a Tales game with a AAA budget that we spent 5 years developing. Oh, wait, it's done in exactly the style you don't want. And there's no other Tales games on the horizon. Having said that, if Namco Bandai ever wises up and decides to do a Tales of Destiny collection with Destiny PS2 and Destiny 2 translated into English and released on literally anything, I will buy the $100+ special edition of it. Oh my god, I love Destiny PS2 so much, it's so good, I love it, I love it, I love it. So, just putting that out there. So you might be mildly curious what happened with the Oculus Direct, because I think a lot of people don't really have their ears to the ground on VR and don't even know it's still a thing. I'm gonna be honest, it wasn't a very good Direct. The main things were that Resident Evil 4 is coming to Quest 2. There's a sort of Left 4 Dead-style shooter called After the Fall, and that's apparently gonna be on Quest, Rift, and PS4, PSVR, and it'll probably be on Steam and on your Valve Index and whatnot. And apparently the developers of 1080 Snowboarding are making a VR snowboarding game called Carve Snowboarding. As for the Quest 2, though, that is a thing I want to talk about because I just picked one of those up, and I hate to admit it, but Facebook just won VR. The Quest 2 is unquestionably the best choice for VR gaming for sensible human beings. In fact, it kind of looks like it's even better than the Valve Index in a lot of ways. The Valve Index has a lot of build issues. The Quest 2 is being sold for $300. You can literally just go to Target and buy one off the shelf. And what it is it's actually a standalone VR game console, just contained in the headset. It uses inside-out tracking, which is the headset itself has cameras in it to detect its position in the room, in order to detect where it is, meaning you don't have to set up little lighthouses and sensors around your room. You literally just put it on and it works, which not only makes it way more convenient, but makes room scale very possible. And all you gotta do is plug in a USB-C cable and it becomes a VR headset for your computer, and it is on par with, and in some cases better than, a Rift S. It's literally the easiest VR you can get. You put it on your head and it just goes. It works. And that sheer amount of ease is incredible. The quality is quite impressive. It's not quite as comfortable as a PSVR, and it doesn't have the same field of view, but it is one of the highest resolution VR headsets out there, and the price tag is really hard to argue with. This is because Facebook is actually selling these at a loss. All of this is kind of unfortunate, because in order to use it, you have to dox yourself. You have to have a Facebook account, which requires you to have a real name, and you have to link it to your headset, and you literally cannot use the headset at all without a Facebook account, which also means that if you break TOS and Facebook decides to ban you, they get to take away all of your games. I've already broken TOS like 7 effing times, so at any minute, Facebook could take away all my shit. But there are literally no fucking alternatives. Like, all other VR headsets are so damn inferior, it's embarrassing. There's definitely still issues in the design and build quality category. And speaking of which, I do need to say, though it's not as bad as the Quest, as the original Oculus Rift, the iBox could still use to be a bit larger on the Quest 2. For those unfamiliar, the original Oculus Rift, the box around the eyes that, you know, goes over your eyes is actually too small, and if you wear glasses, it stabs you in the face with them. The Quest 2 has a glasses spacer included with it, and you can push your glasses forward into the foam and they'll sort of be suspended there, but it's still putting some pressure on your glasses, which is very unfortunate. But it's not uncomfortable if you just embed your glasses in the foam. I wish the iBox was larger, and that was one thing the PlayStation VR got right. It is the absolute most comfortable headset for glasses wearers. Yeah, that's the one thing people don't really tell you about. I had quite an adventure getting stabbed in the face with my glasses in VR. Having said that, I really like VR. I think it has a lot of potential. That inside-out tracking, by the way, it's garbage on Windows Mixed Reality, but the Oculus Rift S and Quest, they use more cameras and it works great. I would say it's the best tracking I've had because the lighthouse style, there's blind spots in that in my room because it's kind of messy, and yeah, the inside-out tracking also makes it way more plausible to do VR in a small space. Man, the Quest 2 is too damn good. It really is the best choice for VR. But I bring all this up about the Quest 2 because Resident Evil 4 VR is for the Quest 2 only. It's not coming to PC. It's not coming to Steam. It is Quest 2 exclusive. Because again, that's an Android-based console. And Android emulation on PC, by the way, is shit. And from my understanding, I think it's actually Oculus doing the conversion to VR. And also, by the way, they've outright said that they are pretty much making their own HD texture pack. They are redoing all the textures. So, yeah, it looks like a thing if you like Resident Evil 4, and, yeah. Quest 2 is better than it has any right to be. Moving on. So, of course, KOF 15 is still dropping trailers, recently revealing the trailer for fan favorite and one of my favorite characters, Blue Mary. And can we just take a moment to appreciate the sheer brilliance of KOF 15's marketing? Like, the way they're just dropping a character trailer every week, Oh my gosh, you absolute geniuses. Because KOF games, they can have like somewhere around 50 characters. KOF 14 had 50 freaking characters. And by doing it this way, just showing a new character trailer every week, not only does it keep it in the public consciousness while you're working on the game, but it keeps all the other FGC people busy. Because of course they're trying to churn out their videos as often as they can. They gotta make content, and oh hey, new KOF trailer, guess I'll do a reaction to that, and bam, every week, everyone's reminded who the new character is. Of course, people are starting to get a little disappointed, because KOF has this certain roster of mainstay characters that you already know are in the game. So, yeah, the fact that there have been a lot of those and not a lot of surprises outside of the Orochi team returning, it has been disappointing some people, and thankfully they've caught on and are doubling up some characters like Ryo and Robert and Ralph and Clark. Beloved characters, but everyone knows you can't have one without the other for the most part. Like, you gonna put Ralph in there and not Clark? Come on. So doubling those up, ain't no one complaining about that. Very good call there. And yeah, I'm excited for the game because, well, I like KOF. I like the huge roster. I've got my fingers crossed for my girl Alice to make it in. Alice and Angel are my two favorites. And I like Malin, but I don't expect her to show up. I'd also love to see Momoko. She's pandering as fuck, but that's kind of adorable. I've got a lot of characters I'd like to see, but at least Yuri's in there. Yuri's always my fallback girl who really needs to just be my main because she's stupid good all the time. It's generally looking good, and what makes me very excited about it even more so is the fact that they're very clearly spending a lot of time on this. A thing I mentioned earlier is that a lot of fighting games this generation have been shat together in like a year or less. Killer Instinct, Street Fighter V, Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite, Dead or Alive 6, and Fighting EX Layer, though that's a bit more excusable, were all confirmed to be put together in like a year or less. And that generally results in some pretty janky low effort fighters. So I'm looking at KOF 15 and they announced that a while ago. They did a lot of preliminary work. And it really looks like, though it should be coming out soon, they've spent more than a year on this. Even if the visuals aren't the most impressive, they've very clearly taken their time with this thing. That said, I am worried mostly because I hate KOF 14. I think KOF 14 plays like crap and I hate it. I'm literally playing KOF All-Stars so I can play as Alice in a game that isn't hot garbage. I hate KOF 14. The controls are stiff, they're nowhere near as responsive as I'd like, and honestly, the auto combo gets in the way of gameplay just way too much. I need an option to turn that off. The auto combo makes that game unfucking playable. Like, I know KOF 13 is considered harder to play, but no, it's way easier to play because it doesn't have a fucking auto combo just screwing everything up. Please, please get rid of that auto combo. It's bad. It's really, really bad for mid-level players. That's the thing. I'm not good at fighting games, and I'm not terrible at fighting games. I'm at exactly the degree of competence where auto combos ruin a game for me because they fuck up the gameplay, if they're not, like, properly built around it anyway. Like, a basic three-hit auto combo that can be canceled into other things, that's good. Auto combos that end in specials, those are garbage. Auto combos that end in supers are super garbage. Like, that should be a fireable offense. But either way, KOF 15 looking great, excited to actually play it. Blue Mary's looking good. Shermie's looking so damn good that I almost want to be a fraud and use her. I'm sorry, I wasn't a Shermie fan before, but right now, yeah, I'd be a fraud, but kind of want to try that. Anyway, in other news, Gentle Criminal and La Brava have been released for My Hero One's Justice 2, which, Christ, that's a terrible name for a game. And along with them, a trailer revealing that a second season of My Hero One's Justice 2 characters are coming. So more than likely, we're going to see Mirko, very, very highly likely. I know there's a lot of demand. I want her in the game too. I'd also like Pony, but, you know, we'll see what we can get. And I'm sure people probably have some mixed feelings towards that, but I think this is a really good call. My Hero 1's Justice 2 is a solid base, and all they'd do for a sequel is just take the same game and add more characters, so may as well just add more characters as DLC, I guess. Makes everything a little bit simpler. If you're wondering if the game is any good, I know there's been a lot of people... Oh my gosh, My Hero 1's Justice 2 is the most misunderstood of all the anime arena fighters. It makes me sad. Because here's the thing, because it's an anime arena fighter, the traditional fighting game fans look at it and they turn their nose up at it. However, the anime arena fighter fans also dislike it because it's not flashy like the Naruto Ultimate Ninja Storm games. They're like, oh, why don't they just have CyberConnect 2 make these games? And I've heard people even say, like, oh, well, it's clear that they just have one engine that they use for all their anime license games, which couldn't be further from the truth. I will tell you right now, Naruto Ultimate Ninja Storm and My Hero 1's Justice 2 play completely different from one another. And that's the sad thing, is My Hero 1's Justice 2, as a single-player game, not very good at all. And that's what a lot of the anime arena fighter fans want. But as a multiplayer, more competitive-esque game, it's actually way better than Naruto Ultimate Ninja Storm. It's fast, it's snappy, it's responsive. I just wish the moveset was a bit bigger and it didn't rely so much on assists, but it's actually relatively solid. Here's the thing, that game is made by Baiking. Baiking are the ex-Capcom developers responsible for the Gundam Versus series and Gunslinger Stratos, and back at Capcom they made Gacha Force, and also they did that Rise of Incarnates game. And yeah, My Hero 1's Justice is running on that same or similar engine, which if you notice is mostly used for projectile fighters, and My Hero 1's Justice is a more close-range fighter. I think there may have also been some executive meddling involved. I know recent patches had screwed up the game's balance pretty badly. I don't know if they've fixed that yet or not. I remember for a minute there's a YouTuber who specializes in anime games called Globku, and he mentioned a while back that it seemed like every new character and every new patch made the game more and more broken, until we got to the point where they had to soft ban Uraraka because she had a infinite, and it was really bad, and it kind of ruined the competitive scene, because he was actually running tournaments for that game, and the tournaments were incredibly hype, because there is tech in the game. Hopefully they've fixed that by now. I'm not sure, I haven't checked in a while, but I'm gonna say that My Hero 1's Justice 2 is not bad, and if you like My Hero Academia and you can find it for like $20, maybe give it a spin, because I think you'll like it. Like, if you just want to pick your favorite My Hero Academia characters and have them fight, it's pretty good. But if you're here for like a single player story mode, oh, you're gonna be disappointed. But yeah, I'm sorry. Went on for a little bit of a tangent there. My Hero 1's Justice is sort of a game I feel bad for. That's a thing that happens with me. I just sometimes feel bad for games because there's a lot of public misconceptions about them. Which brings me conveniently to my next point about a game about superheroes that I feel bad for. So, DC Superhero Girls has gotten so much backlash and such an absurd like-dislike ratio that I'm actually kind of hyped to give it a shot. See, here's what happened. They showed it in the middle of a Nintendo Direct, and they didn't show who the actual developers were, so I think a lot of people saw it and thought that it was an in-house Nintendo game based on this cartoon aimed at girls, and they just assumed that it's garbage shovelware. Even though the game really didn't look that bad. Like, it doesn't look AAA, that's for sure, but it don't look bad. Very well recreates the style of the cartoon. I think people also saw the visual style and mistook it for the grinning potato bean mouth style that people keep calling the CalArts style, which, can we stop doing that? Because here's the thing, CalArts has been around for a very, very long time. Most Western animation comes out of CalArts. I think it might have even been founded by Walt Disney himself. So, like, calling it the CalArts style is really inaccurate. Like, yeah, that's what they teach at CalArts now, but no, it's specifically the grinning potato or bean mouth style, which I'm definitely allergic to. This isn't that, though. This is the My Little Pony Friendship is Magic style. You can tell because Zatanna looks like Twilight Sparkle. But no, seriously. This is just a game based on a cartoon aimed at girls. DC Superhero Girls was DC realizing, hey, we want to get more girls in the comics. We've got a bunch of superheroines laying around. What if we did an alternate universe where they're all high schoolers and they fight crime together? And they did that, and I guess it was decent. And then they did a Gen 2, and they called in Lauren Faust of Friendship is Magic fame to handle it. And that's what we've got here. I've got a friend, though, who really can't stop complaining about the reboot. Even though he likes Friendship is Magic and he likes DC Superhero Girls, he's like, these are not two great tastes that taste great together. He finds the original DC Superhero Girls, Gen 1, to be much more true to the characters, while Gen 2 takes way too many liberties with them. And I've never seen a full episode of either, but I'm inclined to agree. Having said that, I kind of really like the Gen 2 version of the characters more. They're a bit more fun. Though at the same time, they're so exaggerated and wild that I can't help but think that anyone that tried to get into comics off of this show would be disappointed. You got a bad case of the Starfire scenario here. You know how Starfire from the Teen Titans animated series is literally nothing like her comic book counterpart, so when you try to go from animated Teen Titans to the comic book, you get really disappointed. And it was so bad they created the character of Miss Martian to basically be animated Starfire, but for the comics. Yeah, that sort of situation. Anyway, though, here's the thing. I've got a soft spot for Power Girl. And I did a Google search, because every time it's like, okay, there's a new series, does it have any Power Girl in it? And, shockingly, this does. Yeah, there's an episode where Supergirl kind of fakes her death and changes her and goes as Power Girl in order to, like, get a fresh start and change her image and stuff. And it's fucking adorable and I love it. And watching a few clips from that, I realized, wait a second, this Supergirl is just a younger Power Girl. Which, I mean, Power Girl is technically just an older Supergirl, so that makes sense. But no, like, seriously, this is like, this Supergirl is Power Girl, just 100%. And I kind of have my fingers crossed they might include a Power Girl outfit. But even if not, no, she's Power Girl. I mean, look! Totally Power Girl. Anyway, enough joking around. Here's the thing. The actual developer of the game is Toy Box Inc., the makers of Deadly Premonition 2. Yeah, so I looked into this company, and it looks like the founders of it and a lot of people who work there got their start working at Natsume on Harvest Moon 64 and beyond, then jumped ship to Grasshopper Manufacture to work under Suda 51, and are now, like, sort of working a bit with White Owl and doing Deadly Premonition 2 and stuff. So, they seem to specialize in some very strange games, but namely and especially Life Sims. They also made Little Dragon's Cafe. That was another game they made. Never played that one. But they seem to specialize in Life Sims, and DC Superhero Girls appears to be a Life Sim beat-em-up combination. And yeah, you know, you've got, like, a big old city that you can run around in and talk to people. It's got a school life element. You can take selfies and go shopping for clothes. So it's got all of that, but they recently showed in the trailer there's also a town-building aspect. I guess a chunk of Metropolis gets knocked out at the beginning of the game, and you get to rebuild it using the coins you get, and you get to choose what you want to place where all the old buildings used to be. So that's kind of cool. But what I'm really interested in is the beat-em-up aspect. And this is where I really have to say, man, the Western trailers suck. No wonder they've got such a bad like-dislike ratio. Like, seriously, the American trailers are, what makes them so bad is not only are they horrifically uninformative, but they're all done with Barbara Gordon talking directly to the viewer, and I'm sorry, but even as a kid, I hated that shit. Because it's incredibly pandering and out of character. Like, she doesn't sound like Barbara Gordon. It doesn't sound natural. She's flagrantly shilling. And it's just uncomfortable. It feels like they're bastardizing the character whenever they do that. So no, I have a hard time even listening to the American trailers. Japanese trailers, though.
Hi, Mina. Atashi Barbara Gordon.
Yes, I am in fact that much of a weeb. But no, the recent Japanese trailer finally shows the UI and the interface and goes into detail on the gameplay. So yeah, the combat actually looks pretty alright. I'm liking the way the moves are segmented and where the hit stop is. It looks like as your combo gets bigger, the loot drops level up. Yeah, when it says level up in the middle of combat, that's not your character leveling up, that's the loot drops improving. But it does have a level up system. You can put points in the characters and stuff. But yeah, no, the combat looks pretty alright. I see that we've got an attack button, then we got like two superpowers on R1 and R2, or R and ZR, that thing. And they're on sort of a meter there. The other thing I noticed that they went into detail on, though, is that they do have a just dodge system, where if you dodge out of the way of an enemy attack, like, just in time, it will slow down, and if you press the jump button during slowdown, you will do a counterattack. So it at least has mechanics. I'm wondering if it has any tag elements. I'm wondering if it has any, like, secondary attack buttons, if it has charge attacks, if it has any sort of directional inputs, because this combat's looking pretty good. Not like mind-blowing, but pretty decent. And this is where, I hate to admit this, but I was going through Google, trying to see if anyone had a better reason for the backlash surrounding this game, and Kotaku Australia kind of brought up a really good point. There was a lady who wrote an article about this, and she's like, this backlash is unfortunate because she grew up as a little girl who played video games back in the 90s, and most of the girl games that released back then were hot, steaming garbage. And honestly, the situation isn't much better today because I played the Monster High game on Wii. I have it's in jank quality, but I have a full playthrough of that on this channel. I beat that game. It was really bad. And I tried Pretty Princess Party, and that was also really bad. But then on the flip side, Wii Cheer 2 is one of the best games on Wii, and no, I'm not backing down for that. That is the best music game on Wii. Absolutely my most played Wii game. And that's why I have this sort of fascination here. But when you go back and you think about what utter shovelware most games aimed at little girls are, having a game like this with a just dodge mechanic and some pretty decent combat, that's kind of nice. Now, mind you, that's also why I'm intrigued in playing this game, because I don't expect it to get proper reviews. I expect that the reviews are going to be split two ways. You're going to have one group of people that are going to go in super negative, aiming to just utterly hate the game, but then the other group is going to be just as bad, if not worse. And that other group is going to be the people who look at the game and they go, oh, it's for little girls, so it's fine. They'll just let it slide, like they did with Disney Infinity, which is fucking garbage. They're just going to let it slide because, oh, it's for kids, it's for little girls, quality doesn't matter. Fuck your demographics. How is this game as a game for anyone? Like, you can let it slide maybe for difficulty. If it's a bit easy, okay, fine, it's aimed at kids, but it's gotta still be a solid game, and I'm really hoping this turns out. But before I forget, one thing they did show in the trailer that's interesting is that it looks like the playable characters are gonna be three heroes and three villains, which is a bit unfortunate. You'd think they'd have, like, the full hero team playable, but no. Playable characters are Wonder Woman, Batgirl, Supergirl, Star Sapphire, Catwoman, and Harley Quinn. So three heroes, three villains, and it looks like you get to make a team of three with the other two being assists. So that's interesting. I'm wondering if it's because, like, the villains turn kind of goodish later on, or if it's because there's actually a villain campaign in the game. But yeah, I feel bad for anyone who wanted to play Zatanna Sparkle, because that might have been kind of fun. It's a bit of a shame that they don't have her as a playable character. You'd think they'd focus on making the core hero team all playable. I'm fine, though, because I'm just here for Supergirl, and Batgirl's actually pretty adorable, so I'm probably going to try playing her, too. But yeah, that's a little disappointing that they're doing it like that. The other thing that disappoints me, and this has been a running theme, no multiplayer. It's all single player. You'd think this would be a really good game to have some drop-in, drop-out co-op action. But no, all single player. But either way, I'm actually looking forward to picking this up next Friday and seeing if it's actually a decent game in its own right, or if it's hot steaming garbage or something somewhere in between, which is highly likely. Either way, with the information you have now about the actual developer, some of the mechanics of the game, and really looking at how it looks in action, let's look at those like-dislike ratios again and realize just how ludicrous this is. Just really want to put that out. And it's here that someone is going to turn around and go, wait a second, hold on, Joe. You said you're not gonna buy Tales of Arise, but you're gonna buy DC Superhero Girls. Bitch, don't question me. Anyway, this is Gel, and you've been game babbled. See ya. Hopefully for a part 2.